Amigos, shout out Zaytoven one time.
Amigos drinking at the Versace store.
Ooh. Yeah. Versace, Versace, Medusa head on me like I'm Numinati.
What's going on, YouTube? Goody Two Shoes back with another video for you guys. And today, we are back with a brand new podcast, The Rap Episode 4, I believe. Now, the first thing I want to touch on is the last episode of The Rap. I uploaded it, and in like the first 2 or 3 days, I think I had like 5 views. And that's like normally what I'm getting right now on all my podcasts and every video basically that I put up is like 5-ish views. And that makes sense because I have like 6 subscribers or something like that. So it makes sense that I would have about 5. And I checked it. I checked my most recent podcast yesterday, and it doubled the views in the last like 3 or 4 days of the week. It's now at 11 views, so that was really exciting to me. It's just like a big morale booster when you see your video sitting at 5, and then I just went to check all my videos and just figured it'd still be at 5 because I checked it 2 or 3 days after I put it up and it was at 5. And surprisingly, seeing that 11 was just a huge surprise to me, and I can't thank you guys enough for all tuning in to the podcast. It's super fun for me to record, super easy, super fun, and I just like to talk about sports. So it's something I really like to do, so it's a fun time. So let's get right into it. Today on the for the slate of what we have to talk about, we've got Warriors hype versus Cavs hype. Talking a lot about the East and Western Conference in basketball. Steph winning the first unanimous MVP in league history, Dwight Howard drama, and finally, if we have time, I hope we do, we're gonna talk about the Big 12 expansion in college sports. So without further ado, let's get right into things with the Warriors hype. So a couple of things that I've pinpointed are offense and defense for both, and then their records, both meaning the Warriors and the Cavs, just because those are the two favorites for each conference right now. The Warriors hype, they have a 7-2 overall record this playoffs. And I said they have like bad defense. Don't take that too out of proportion. I don't think they have terrible defense, but everybody talks about how good their defense is. We're going to be talking strictly postseason here. They've allowed 100 or more points 4 times in the postseason, and 2 of those times they've allowed 120 or more points. They only allowed 100 points once to Houston, but Houston is a train wreck of a team, and if anybody thinks that Houston is better than the Pistons by saying that the Cavs have played nobody and the Warriors had to play the Rockets in the first round and the Blazers in the second round. The Blazers aren't a great team. They're definitely better than the Rockets. But the Rockets do not compare to either the Hawks or the Pistons. And I know it the sweep of the Hawks made them look like a terrible team, but they are in reality not that bad. The Cavs are just playing very hot right now. So we talked about them allowing a lot of points per game. That, to me, is bad defense rather than great offense and people just having a shootout. I know that the Warriors play a lot of up-tempo offense, so that really generates more possessions and more shots for each team. So maybe that's why they allow a lot more points. But still, if you're such a great defensive team, I feel like you should allow less points. And then their offense, everybody always talks about their offense and how well they shoot the three and all that stuff. Shocking statistics are they shoot 47.6% of their field goals and 40.3% of their three-pointers. They average about 12 makes per game, and they average 13.2 turnovers per game. So when I give you the Cavs stats, I'll compare those. So the Cavs record is 8-0 compared to the Warriors 7-2 record this year. I'm going to try to not be biased and just ignore the whole West is more difficult than the East as long as I can. But yeah, so the Cavs are 8-0 versus the Warriors 7-0. The Cavs defense has been much better, in my opinion. They've only allowed 100 or more points 2 times this postseason, and they have never allowed 120 points or more. The Warriors allowed 104 times, like I said, and 122 times. So they doubled both of those. The Cavs have been shooting extremely hot, especially in the Hawks series. They shot extremely well. I think they tied the record in the Pistons series for most three-pointers in a postseason game, and then the Warriors broke it like 2 days later or something. And now the Cavs rebroke it with 25 three-pointers in a game, and that was just insane. I remember watching that game. They had 18 at halftime. It felt like they just couldn't miss. So that was really cool. But they make 46.1% of their field goals as compared to the 47.6% by the Warriors. So the Warriors' overall field goal percentage is a percent and a half better than the Cavs. But the Cavs' three-point percentage is 46.2% as compared to the 40.3% by the Warriors. So that's a full, almost 6 full points better of three-point percentages made. And they make 16.8 average three-pointers made per game to the Warriors' 12. So that's almost 5 whole three-pointers made more per game. And they turn the ball over 10.9 times per game on average. So that's just over two less than the Warriors per game. So they're taking care of the ball better. They're shooting the three much better and shooting more threes per game than the Warriors, who are always thought to be like the biggest three-point shooting threat, as they do have the best two shooters in the game. But when the Cavs are on, they can absolutely light you up and shoot you out of the gym. So watch out. And a really interesting fact is that the Cavs are 12-0 all time when the big three of Kevin Love, LeBron James, and Kyrie Irving all start in a game in the postseason. They're 12-0. They have not lost a game. Now, that's not obviously going to continue forever, but that is a very good statistic, and they do have the two sweeps this year. So another little side note is that a lot of people have actually been recently picking the Cavaliers as their title favorites, most notably Dr. J, after Steph returned and lit up the Blazers in overtime the other night. Even after that, Dr. J said that the Cavaliers are his title favorite and should be everyone's title favorite, which is very surprising to me because I just figured everybody would say that the Warriors are the title favorites and that the Cavs would be the underdog, in which I'm assuming a lot of people are saying that, but not everybody, so that's good. Now, with this whole West is harder than the East drama, I'm just going to touch on it very quickly. The 8 playoff teams in the East versus the 8 playoff teams in the West. Obviously, Golden State is very superior to everyone, as well as San Antonio. I'll give you that. San Antonio was also a very good team during the regular season. Oklahoma City, in my opinion, the top three teams in the NBA are Golden State, followed by San Antonio, followed by Cleveland. But that's during the regular season. Now, during the postseason, I would say Golden State is number, well, it's hard to say Golden State versus Cleveland, but I'll put Golden State at number one just because of what they can do. Cleveland at number two, San Antonio at number three, and then Oklahoma City at number four. Oklahoma City, in my opinion, is not better than Cleveland, and they were not during the regular season. So that's where I say that it drops off of saying that the West is super superior to the East, is that they have two teams. Yes, they have two teams that could definitely beat every team in the East, and the Golden State Warriors and San Antonio Spurs. But Oklahoma City, the LA Clippers, and the Portland Trailblazers, all of them to me are pretty like two or three seeds in the West, maybe a four seed, or in the East, maybe a four seed in the East. But then in the East, you have Toronto, Miami, and Atlanta. Miami, Atlanta, Boston, and Charlotte all finished the regular season at 48-34. That means in the East. In the East, the worst team to make the playoffs record was 44-38, which would put them at a 5 seed in the East, I keep mixing these up just because I'm looking at a little sheet of paper over here by my table. Detroit was 44-38 in the East, and they were an 8 seed. And in the West, that would put them above Portland, tied with Portland at 44-38, at the 5 seed. So everybody always talks about how, oh, the West got three teams over four or over 500 that didn't make the playoffs, and the East had teams that were under 500 in the playoffs. It is the exact opposite this year, yet everyone, all the talking heads are still saying that the West is way more superior than the East. In fact, this year, Chicago at 42 and 40 and Washington at 41 and 41 both missed the playoffs in the East, and the 7th seed in the West was 42 and, well, the 6th seed in the West was 42 and 40, as well as the 7th seed in Dallas and then Memphis, and then the 8th seed Houston was 41 and 41. So that's two teams in the East that could have made it in the West. And that to me just blows my mind, because everybody always talks about how the West is better, and clearly it's the opposite. Well, it's not really. I don't think it's the opposite. I think that they're very evenly matched, besides Golden State and San Antonio. I'm just going to move on from that, because I don't love spending a whole lot of time talking about that. We're going to move right into Steph Curry being the first unanimous MVP in league history. So, in league history, yes, he was the first unanimous MVP. Did I think that he was going to get it? No. Do I think he deserved it? Absolutely. But I figured there would be somebody that would vote for a LeBron James, or somebody that would vote for a Russell Westbrook, because of all the triple-doubles that he had this year. Just a little interesting fact, LeBron James and Shaquille O'Neal are the only two other players to come within one vote of being unanimous MVPs. And then Steph obviously was the unanimous MVP this year. A funny story about the whole unanimous MVP thing is, I have friends that know I'm a diehard Cavs fan and I do not like Steph Curry. And when this happened, I had a friend who tagged me in a Facebook post and said, look, Steph Curry was the first unanimous MVP in league history, whatever. She tagged me in that, and then I replied and I said, do you even know what unanimous means? Because I didn't know if she would understand what that meant, and she actually replied and said, nope. But it said first, so I just figured it was a cool thing. So that right there shows that people like Steph Curry, and they don't even know what they're talking trash about. So unanimous meaning that everyone gave their first place vote to Steph Curry, so nobody else got a first place vote. So that is what unanimous means, for all you guys wondering who don't know and still like to tag people like myself who are Cavaliers fans in comments and trash talk us. That is what it means. So the voting was Steph 1, Kawhi Leonard 2, LeBron was like 4 points behind him, I think, at 3, Russell Westbrook at 4, and Kevin Durant at 5. Steph not only won the voting, but he doubled and added like another 100 or so points to the second place finisher, who was Kawhi Leonard. So that's insane. He blew him out of the water. Another thing, Tracy McGrady, he's on an NBA show called The Jump on ESPN. He actually said that Steph being the first unanimous MVP shows how washed up the NBA is these days compared to when he played and when nobody was unanimous. That really set off a lot of people, especially Warriors fans, and I completely disagree with him. Even though I do not like the Warriors or Steph Curry, he had an unbelievable season, and I'm not going to take anything away from him. He was fantastic. I'm just not going to take anything away from him, and I do not think that it was the league is washed up at all. We had Russell Westbrook, who had like 19 triple-doubles or something like that, a crazy amount of triple-doubles. I think he even set like a record for most in a single season. And then Kawhi Leonard, he's a beast on both ends of the floor. LeBron's always going to get votes for MVP, at least I hope so. And then Kevin Durant coming back from his foot surgery last year, he had a phenomenal season as well. So all five of those guys are definitely deserving of votes. And I don't think our league is washed up at all. And I think he'll see that. Tracy McGrady will see that and he'll regret what he said. I don't think he'll ever take it back, but I think he'll regret it. So moving on to the next topic, we have all of the Dwight Howard drama that took place last night into today. A lot of people are questioning whether he's still dedicated to the game, and he shot down those rumors right away. But then again, he's so laid back that you can't tell if he actually means it or not. So a lot of people had a lot of discrepancy on that. The main question right now is what team he's going to go to if he leaves or stays. And if he's going to get a max deal or if he is going to be more of a role player, which really depends on what he wants and where he wants to go. He can opt out this summer of his Rockets deal. I think they said he'll make like $23 million if he opts back into his contract with the Rockets this year, and then he'll be a free agent again next summer for a whole new restructured deal. Possible landing spots that people have talked about for Dwight Howard were the Magic, which is where he came from when he was drafted. Reasons why he would go there is just because he was drafted there. That's like home to him, I guess. And he was very dominant there. He won Defensive Player of the Year 3 years in a row there from 2008 till 2011, the 2008-2009 season, 2009-2010 season, and 2010-2011 season. So all three of those years, he won Defensive Player of the Year. Now, people have also talked about him going to the Bucks, which they have said he could probably get a max deal there and play there and be more of a team ball type deal. He could be more into it would be like his team, I guess. He'd be the one star. And actually talk came out today that it would be possible for him to join the Warriors. That's kind of scary. They do have Andrew Bogut right now, and I'm guessing that if they got Dwight Howard, they would either have Andrew Bogut on the bench, or that they would just cut him to save some, maybe not just cut him, but try and trade him and get rid of his cap. Dwight would have to take a huge pay cut to go to Golden State. He would be more of a role player, like a defensive player specifically. But there's no doubt in my mind that he would be very good on the Warriors just because of how well they spread the ball and how unselfish they are. I think he would get a lot of open dunks at the rim, cutting to the rim. And I think he would fit very well in their system as their center just because he's a defensive anchor, and that's kind of what they use Bogut as. They don't really use him on the offensive end that much, so I think he would fit perfectly there, but he would have to take a huge pay cut and be more of a role player. Another option is that he could stay in Houston. He's expressed a lot of disinterest in that on the court. He has not shown or said anything about wanting to leave or stay, or leave for that matter, off the court. But on the court, he just looks disinterested in the team. And I think it's because he went there thinking that it would be him and James Harden sharing the load. And it's been a lot of just James Harden hogging the ball. And I don't think he's really a big fan of that. I think he wants to be more involved in the system. So he could stay. And the reasons for that would be he's staying where he's at. He doesn't have to make another move. Plus, he would be making $23 million next year or something like that. And that's a lot of money. So the last two landing spots that he could go to are obvious: New York for the Knicks and Los Angeles for the Lakers, just because it's big markets. I don't think he would go back to the Lakers, as he was already there once. But the reasons he would go there is because it's a big market. He could get more endorsement deals like he had in the past, and he could just get a ton of money on a max contract anyway, because both those teams are pretty bad. Looking for a superstar and a big player that also has some experience. So I don't think he'd go back to LA. I think possibilities are he either goes to the Magic or stays in Houston. Possibly goes to the Warriors, I guess. I don't know. I think he'll test the free agent waters, but I think he'll either end up in Orlando or staying in Houston. But I would love to have him on the Cavaliers, specifically as a sixth man role off the bench. Just giving the Cavaliers somebody to back up Tristan Thompson, who can play defense and who can rebound, block shots, whatever. Just somebody who can dive to the rim, I guess, because after Tristan Thompson, our next guy we put in for center is Channing Frye. And yes, I like Channing Frye, and he can knock down threes, but I guess I would rather have him at the power forward position just because he can stretch the floor. He's very good for small ball, and I think Dwight Howard is a great addition to any team just because of his rebounding ability, his blocking shots ability, and he can always dive to the rim. He's a very athletic guy, so I think he's an addition more than a subtraction to any team, and I wouldn't mind him in Cleveland, but that's only at the right price. I'm not going to give him a max deal, so maybe $15 to $20 million a year. Maybe not 20 a year. That's a little much. maybe even 15 is a lot. 12, I'd say in the range of like 12 to 16 is what I would offer Dwight Howard per year. Probably like a 3-year deal, $36 million or something like that. Maybe 38, maybe 40 million over 3 years. Not exactly sure what I would give him. Probably somewhere in that range though. 36 to 40 million over 3 years. But moving on to our next topic, if we have enough, I think we'll have just enough time to talk about this, is the Big 12 expansion. There's been rumors coming out the past couple, 3 days talking about expansion in the Big 12. It's always been a thing or a topic recently because they do only have 10 teams and it is the Big 12. And I think the Big 10 has like 14 or 16 teams in it and they are called the Big 10. So it doesn't really make sense based on the names of the conferences, and I don't think they want to rename the conference. Although there have been rumors that they want to try and make it the Pac-16 and the Big 16, and then they would have like the SEC, the Big 10, is that the only other two? ACC? Yeah, ACC as the other three power conferences, or however many, four power conferences, right? SEC, ACC, Big 10, Big 16, Pac-16. Is that it? I think so. Whatever. If I'm forgetting anybody, I'm sorry. But the expansion, the teams that they have really been interested in and actually received letters from, I guess, of wanting to join is Houston, who had a very good football season this past year. Memphis, who also had a pretty good football season and basketball season. UCF, Central Florida, and Colorado State. Now, other teams that have been mentioned are BYU and Cincinnati and UConn, teams from the old Big East that are now in the American Athletic Conference, I believe, the AAC. So just a lot of teams from there and a lot of smaller schools. I wouldn't mind having more teams in the Big 12, just because that way we could have a conference championship in football. It's not like a huge deal that we don't to me, but it is a lot. It is to a lot of other people. We don't really get the respect that we should in the college football playoffs, selection, all that stuff. Just because we don't have a conference title game doesn't mean that we don't have good teams. And I think that a lot of the people on the committee don't really understand that. So I wouldn't mind having those people, but one thing they have talked about is how would they split up the division. If they did it horizontally, they would have North and South, which wouldn't really be fair. Depending on what teams were added, it wouldn't be fair, because then in the South region, you would have Texas, Oklahoma, Texas Tech, Baylor, TCU, all those teams in the South. And in the North, you would have Kansas, Iowa State, Kansas State, West Virginia. You wouldn't have those big football programs. Now, in basketball, it would be more even, but for all sports, I guess you can't really say you want to or don't want to split up that division like that, because times change, coaches change, recruiting changes, teams can get better, teams can get worse. Texas was at the top, then they fell all the way to the bottom, and now they're trying to climb back up. There's just a lot of changes that can be made and that can happen, so you can't really say the division split would be uneven also, because there are multiple sports, and you can't just make decisions based off of football or just off of basketball or whatever. So one way that they propose to split the divisions is that they would take two Texas teams for each division. They would have two Texas teams, so just for example, they would have Texas and Texas Tech in the South or whatever, and then they would have, each division would have an Oklahoma team, so we'll add Oklahoma State to our current division, and then a Kansas team to each division, so we'll add Kansas. So we would have Texas Tech, Texas, Oklahoma State, and Kansas in our conference, and then the other conference there would be Baylor, TCU, Oklahoma, and Kansas State, and then they would have Iowa State in one division and West Virginia in the other. So if we added two more teams, then they would just evenly split those up. That, to me, would make a lot more sense, so that you don't have all of the Texas teams in one division and then all of the other teams basically in another division. So say they added Houston and one other team. Houston's in Texas, so that would make five teams in Texas, and so they would all pretty much have all Texas teams and then like an Oklahoma and Oklahoma State. And then in the North Division, they would have Kansas, Kansas State, Iowa State, West Virginia. Who am I forgetting? Is there anybody else? And then what other team they added? I think that's only five. But whatever, yeah. It just makes a lot more sense to me to have two Texas teams, one Oklahoma team, and one Kansas team in each division. That just seems a little more split up evenly, in my opinion. If you guys, I think that's all that I have time for on the podcast today. I got through all my topics, and we are running about 25 minutes long in this podcast. If you guys haven't checked out my other video recently that I put up earlier today, it was a rare supply drop opening on Call of Duty Black Ops 3. That was pretty cool. Really fun. I'm hoping to make like a, not like a series out of it, maybe a mini series you would call it, where I just save up crypto keys and open up supply drops and whatever every so often, maybe once a month or whatever. I think that'd be pretty fun. But go check that out. There's definitely some cool things in there that you don't want to miss. And this episode of the podcast was number three since I changed it to the actual pod, to a podcast format, but fourth overall. I want to thank you guys for joining me. Make sure you check out all of my other videos on this channel. What I wanted to talk about really quick was two series that will be coming, definitely by the summertime, but hopefully sooner. I guess it is summer for most of us, but towards the end of June, maybe early July, is when I want it to be the absolute latest that this comes out. But I want to be able to upload two Call of Duty series to my channel. I want to do a Road to Dark Matter, where I'll be playing just Team Deathmatch, Domination, whatever, public matches online on the road to getting to Dark Matter. I want Dark Matter very bad, and I know I got a late start on it, but I just really have been in the mood to grind lately on that Dark Matter. So then another series would be Race to Master Prestige, which would be episodes of me and Jake, my buddy Jake from high school. We would both be recording the same... Well, we wouldn't both be recording because he doesn't record, but I would record when both of us are playing and when both of us are playing only, and we would race to Master Prestige. We are both First Prestige level 50, I believe, right now as we sit on the game. So once that these series do come out, I do hope to upload a Call of Duty video every other day, or maybe every day, just because I think that I could upload a Road to Dark Matter every day that I don't upload. Well, I could probably upload a Call of Duty video every day, because I could do Road to Dark Matter, Race to Master Prestige, and Game Battles matches, whether that be 2v2s or 1v1s. I could just rotate the three of those. So yeah, I could do a Call of Duty video every day, and then hopefully by the summer, the end of the summer, I can have a vlogging camera, and we'll be able to record some vlogs and stuff for you guys. And then I could upload a vlog every afternoon, not night, but afternoon. And then obviously Wednesdays would still be my podcast. So a super full schedule, pumping out a lot of videos for you guys. So make sure you subscribe to my channel. Follow me on Twitter so you don't miss out on anything. Like this video if you enjoyed, if you had a good time listening, hanging out, chilling, talking sports. And make sure you comment with what you guys want to see next week and other series you might want to see, because I don't want this channel to be dominated by Call of Duty or podcasts only or whatever. I do want to have a mix, so whether that be internet games, Minecraft, other console games, or Call of Duty podcast, vlogs, whatever, truth is, stuff like that. I do have a bunch of video ideas for when I get a vlogging camera, So that'd be super fun. Let me know what you guys think. This has been your boy Goody Two Shoes. I want to thank you guys all for joining me today, and we will see you guys next week on the podcast. Peace. Telling you I got it, anybody thinking different, gonna get it, futuristic, be that nigga killing every single city, grabbing titties, even if they itty bitty, leaving niggas shitty, drinking, think I need another kidney, if you with me, say hell yeah.